Then the darkness becomes absolute. Am I going into a mirror? Okay. I was dying. I wasn't sure if I was dying or going into this. Yeah. It sounds familiar, like something I've heard in another game, all this part. In every direction, all is gray, a dreary sky above the calm sea on which you float. The air is wet and lukewarm like the water below. The only sound is the wind's susurrus, so faint as to raise no waves. I'm a little lower than intelligence that I like. Weightless and alone, you're not deprived of sensations, but relieved of them. For a moment, you bask in something like rapture, a purely physical bliss that belongs to this body, not to you. Then it's gone, replaced with a rush of terror and rage and violation. Go away, your mind screams at you. Without your will, against your will, your body convulses. You are no longer floating effortlessly. You are thrashing desperately, trying and not trying to drown. Let me just read this. I'm trying to comprehend all this. Only sound. So, I'm floating in a calm sea. I'm deprived. I'm relieved of sensations. A rush of terror and rage and violation. Well, let's try this. Tread water to keep from going under. Try as you might, you can't achieve anything like a proper rhythm. Your arms and legs jerk spastically as another consciousness tries to move them at the same time. Out! The voice shrieks. You can't take this from me. You won't. You recognize the voice now. It's Inifere's, only seized by a wild terror the cast-off never showed in the flesh. He doesn't seem to be trying to drown, but he is clearly unwilling or unable to let you keep your body, his body, the flesh that houses you both, afloat. Why is his mind still here? This never happened before. Right, instead of living through him, he's still here. You slip underwater and discover you're not alone. Dozens of corpses bob around you, some just a few feet from the surface, some in the darker depths. Among them is Choi Kasul. It's no longer quiet. What had seemed the whisper of a breeze was, in fact, the droning of the dead. Now, with the water's amplification, you can hear them directly. Filth. Worthless slut. Traitor. Nobody. Monster. Some jeer. Shame. Shame, moans another. Fraud, one cries out. Clear as truth, Choi just weeps. Inifere's consciousness seems overwhelmed by the tumult. Your body stopped flailing and is merely sinking. But his innervation affects you as well, and your limbs feel leaden and lightless. Force yourself to swim towards the surface, towards Choi, or downwards. Swim towards Choi? Am I dying now? Every stroke is a struggle. This body is already weaker than the one to which you've become accustomed, and it balks at your commands like a spent anine. Inifere is not working against you, but his will sits between your thoughts and the body's actions. Consciousness may weigh nothing, but his is dragging you down all the same. Helplessly, you gulp for air and swallow only piss-warm water. You fight harder, but lose even more ground. The weak light of the world above is already fading. Not dead yet. As you sink deeper into the dismal sea, I mean, would we die from that? We're living a memory, right? This isn't our actual physical form being affected. As you sink deeper into the dismal sea, you can make out the shadow of something below the corpses. So you drag down under anyway. Something huge and ancient and awful, all teeth and hunger, which needs no words to convey how small and mean and meaningless you are. Okay, so that teeth thing that keeps attacking us. Loathing wells up, not from below, but from within. Your flesh and mind resonate with that overpowering will, and your body trembles. A single massive eye opens, and in a glance, assays your entire self. You realize for the first time that you are naked. You see your spindly limbs and sallow pockmarked skin, your unsexed, withered, worthless body, and you are ashamed. And then, everything's gone, and there's nothing but the liminal darkness between dream and reality, life and death, madness and reason. Okay, we'll say, Inifere? At first there's no reply, but you know he's in here still, thwarted, sullen. In time he answers. Who are you? You're not like the others. You're still awake, scheming, grasping. You feel different, like him. How are you here? I've never tasted you. He pauses briefly in his demands, and you feel his consciousness brush against yours. Who are you? For all his frantic questioning, your brother is not yet the madman you met beyond the gate. His mind may be cracked, but it is not shattered. What were those things? The others, those bodies and the creatures beneath? Inifere laughs. Weren't you paying attention? Dead men tell so many tales of torment, and Father made me listen with my mouth, fatten me on grief. Now they're in my flesh and blood. His thoughts rub across yours like oily feathers. As for the dark ones, he pulls away and falls silent. Inifere, are you still there? You sense his seething consciousness lurking somewhere in your mind, but he gives no response. Wait. Time passes or doesn't. The darkness does not lighten. The silence does not lift. Inifere is out there. You can sense him, but only vaguely. Besides him and you, there is nothing here at all. Even the dead are, for the moment, speechless. Try one. You sense his seething consciousness lurking somewhere in your mind, but he gives no response. Nothing changes. You are between moments, and Inifere's patience appears infinite. One. Three. Okay, the only thing we can do is wake up. You try to will yourself awake, but Inifere clings to the darkness. Its solace and solitude, and forces your flesh back into slumber. So this is how it will be, a test of wills. But for all his resistance, Inifere's consciousness soon retreats into the darkness of your mind, whimpering, giving way. It seems he has little stomach for battle. Inifere, are you still there? Keep waiting. One, three. Fight, Inifere, force yourself to wake up. Ooh. You are on a hard bed beneath a coarse sheet. Voices again surround you, though their words the same as the corpse curses. Slut, one chants in an endless mantra. Another mutters, shame, shame. You're thinking about Game of Thrones. Punctuated by the slap of rawhide. But these aren't the voices from the dream, only echoes. Your eyes open, and you see as never before. Nothing's added or subtracted, but certain details take on new clarity. The mold blossoming from cracked plaster. The blemishes on the weary, rattled face of the woman at your bedside. I don't know that word. Rattled with D's. I know rattled, you know, double T's. The sores weeping on another attendant's arms. You're not just in Inifere's body. You're in his misery. The master has spoken. The master has awoken. The woman cries. She faces the others. Let us give thanks, they kneel. And she turns back to you, eyes gleaming with the pleasure of power. Master, thank you for redeeming us in our suffering, for revealing how, by receiving the world's cruelty, we may escape the world's bondage. Wait, are we in Inifere's body when he was still inhabited by the changing god? Her humility is cheap and hollow, but the others are deaf to the hypocrisy. They murmur their thanks. Morcissa. Inifere sighs her name, and you're stabbed with his feelings for her. Contempt and craving alloyed into something harder and sharper than love. So this is the woman who served as Ronus's guide. Something else nags at you, but before you can grasp it, Inifere realizes you're still in his mind, and howls out. Inifere, stop fighting me. Never, he hisses. We will war for every thought and every second of your occupation until you leave me be. Let's use anamnesis. Force your way into Inifere's memories of Marcissa. Success! You plunge deeper into Inifere's mind, and remember that day when he first saw the fraud in Marcissa's eyes as she told the children that the wretchedness of their lives had meaning, not just some meaning, but the only meaning that mattered. She said it as she always had, but he understood that, like him, she knew that the only secret of suffering was that it had no secret, no purpose. Like all Inifere's thoughts, this one is rotten, but it has Rot's overpowering sweetness, too, for here was a certainty. However loathsome he might be, she was worse. With that one look, Inifere understood that Marcissa had come to the same end as him, miserable among the miserable, not by fate, or misfortune or fault of birth, but by choice. She came to grub for the shabbiest of vanities, not even to be the first among the least, but to be second. So when the dead voices whipped up waves to drown him in self-hate, Inifere knew he could always cling to the fact of her shameless grasping after shame and keep from sinking into oblivion. The memory slips away, and you are back in the bedroom, seeing Marcissa all the more clearly through Inifere's eyes. I'm gonna say aloud, stop. There's no salvation in the gate. You're only hurting yourselves and others. Marcissa shoots you a look that is surely cagey, then addresses the children. The master frees us from the flesh pots of certainty, the luxury of easy faith. He gives us doubt, and the anguish of the grasping soul. We doubt, the others answer. We suffer. Marcissa nods sharply. We doubt, but we do not stray. The master rebukes us, and we receive the rebuke. The whip cracks, and the flesh rises up. The flesh rises up to meet it. A cultist brings a crop down across his shoulders in response, crying out more in ecstasy than pain. We thank you, Master, for the fire that burns, for the fire that lights the way. Help us to comprehend the wholeness of suffering, so that we may open the gate. In your mind, Inifere snorts with contempt. For you, for them, for the world. You think I haven't tried to save them from this foolishness? They can't escape their madness any more than I can escape them. I am a prophet who cannot be falsified. He recedes once more into sulking silence. Listen, I am telling you to stop worshipping me. We doubt, the cultists cry. We suffer. One? Nope. Kill Marcissa. Focus on the nagging sensation? You try to shut out the room around you. The litanies chanted by the cultists, the sharp sounds of pain being inflicted and received. As the outside world fades, an inner one rises up. The same accusations from the dream resound inside you. Not spoken, but understood. A drone of humiliation and loathing and disgust that drowns out other thoughts and feelings. Still there is something more. Not the dead. Not Inifere. Not you. Something like a little chime ringing inside your eye. The ward, cries Inifere. He's here. My father is here. Okay, so now the changing god's here. So we're not really... I wasn't right about that. We're not living Inifere's life as the changing god controls it. But, yeah. Him. So he was a lord over all these subjects. Inifere leaps from the bed, fully in control of your shared body. The sheer force of his exuberance sends your thoughts reeling. As adrenaline floods his flesh, you turn giddy, but it only seems to sharpen his thoughts. Now, children, we are to be tested. His voice is greased with unpracticed insincerity, but the others cry out in joy. Now comes one who would steal the keys to the gate and twist the rising path of suffering into a downward spiral. You cross the room in long, quick strides, but we are not unready. Let us meet him in the gallery. Rough-hewn stairs lead to an enormous room, more cavern than hall, that ends in wooden gates. The chiming of the wards is louder, faster. The chatter of the dead is incessant, but more than anything you feel the weight of Inifere's will and the bloody purpose to which it is put. All these years he has expected your father's return. His mind repeats over and over, not helpless, not again, not helpless, not again. You know what he knows, that under the floor there are Numenera, that hidden in the cracks and crevices are ciphers. You see what he sees, the faithful girding themselves for battle. This is not a homecoming, it is an ambush. What exactly are you planning to do? Inifere nods to Marcissa, who hands him a barbed spear graven with strange geometric glyphs. He dips it in his flesh and wets its tip with blood. Your blood. His blood. I mean to let him taste what I have lived, Inifere whispers. Oh my. Suddenly the gates shatter inward. Before the splintered wood and twisted iron even hit the floor, the children have fallen to their knees, sobbing, clutching their ears, helpless. It is not your father who has come. Sorrow. Floating in the breach, wreathed in smoke, is the sorrow. For the moment, it makes no move, though it gives no hint as to why. It's not him, Inifere whispers, as though he still stands. And though he is still stand, he is as paralyzed as his followers. Marcissa acts first, pushing herself to her feet, and shrieking commands. Receive the horror. Embrace it. Stand. Guard the master. Obey the master. The others rise uncertainly, while the sorrow abides, Inifere remains stupefied. I have a spear. I'm guessing I can only do one thing. Because while I'm studying it, or throwing spear or saying things, it's moving and things are moving forward. Force Inifere to spring the traps. You dredge your mind until you find Inifere's consciousness, but he wrenches away as you try to catch hold of him. Hide, 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 he repeats, scuttling away into some dark, unthinking corner. The sorrow remains unmoving within the breach in the gateway. It makes no gesture, issues no demands. It is waiting for something, or looking for something, or pondering. There is no way to judge what passes within its mind, if it even has more than a mere instinct. You feel the tides washing around you, stirred up by the sorrow's arrival, but here in Inifere's body, in his mind, you have no means to turn them to your advantage. So if it's just waiting, we can, like, study this thing. It is an object that defies scrutiny. You are certain it's the same thing you faced before, but it's different, and not just in subtle ways. Its texture and even anatomy seem altered, and indeed they continue altering before your eyes. But exactly how it is changing you cannot say, just as you cannot manage to wrap your mind around its contours. The more you look at it, the more your head aches. No, not your head. Something else, something more fundamental. Whatever it is inside you that calls the tides and answers them. That is where the pain is. At last you break your gaze, unable to maintain it any longer. Its texture seem altered and they continue altering. It's linked to the tides in some way, definitely. I mean, it seeks us out when we use the tides. The pain is whatever it is inside you that calls the tides and answer them. So they're both linked some way. The smoke around the sorrow churns and its alien gaze sweeps across the room with a predator's contempt for kind, but without a predator's hunger. Oh, that means kind. Its patience, like its resolve, is inexhaustible and almost indifferent. The children cower as its gaze passes over them, and some cry out, Master, save us! But Inifere is gone, hidden somewhere in the recesses of your mind, as indifferent to the terror as he was to their praise. Inifere, listen to me. This thing, it's called a sorrow. It will kill you all if you don't act. For a moment, Inifere gives no reply. Then his voice choked, and shrill with terror, he says simply, "Run, hide, we must escape. We, a form of progress in the face of annihilation." The sorrow sweeps forward into the hallway, moving so fast you can hardly track it. It swaddles one of the children in its shifting limbs, and it releases him. He is simply snuffed out. Not dead, but gone. The sorrow pauses above its kill, and it seems to read the room again, seeking without finding, but is implacable as ever. Spring the traps? He doesn't seem to care. Throw your spear at the sorrow? You fling the spear with all the strength Inifere's muscles can muster, which is not much, not compared to the body you left behind. The weapon is surprisingly light, a masterpiece of the killing arts. It soars toward your foe as if steered and propelled by some internal mechanism. The glyphs flow. It goes within a foot of the sorrow before a wisp of smoke touches it, and the spear disintegrates into a cloud of drit. A moment later, the tiny shards drop to the floor. The sorrow is not merely unharmed, but unfazed. As the sorrow begins to stir again, Marcissa grabs you by the shoulder, her nails drawing blood. "Enough!" she hisses. She pulls you back, and you find yourself following. She's pulled Inifere back, too, it seems. As you retreat, Marcissa cries out, "Stand! Rise upon the pain!" The slaughter that ensues behind you is strangely silent. Shuffling steps, half-hearted battle cries, smothered deaths. Marcissa hurries you through a warren of tunnels until you pass to another gate. This one made not of wood and iron, but of solid azure steel. As you pass through, the vault seals shut behind you. So I'm guessing there's nothing we could have done to save them. I mean, they're attacking now anyway, even though we told them not to attack. And I don't think... we tried to force him to use the traps, it didn't work, so I don't think telling him to would have made a difference. Is that Marcissa? The room has the faded opulence of a lost civilization. The ornate reliefs carved from the granite walls have crumbled and eroded to abstract deformities. Ancient, flickering lights line the ceiling. Their humming resonates with the metal floor, and their bluish light illuminates the tarnish. In the center of the room, a silver throne rests upon a dais. Unlike the floor, the throne shrines as if recently polished. Tiny, gleaming needles line the armrests, and a halo-like ring hangs above the back. Marcissa is doubled over, gasping for breath, retching. Your own body, weak as it may be, is untroubled. Inifere is gone again, yet something lingers like spores from his mind infecting yours. So, yeah, we're in his mirror, but we're also ourselves. So this throne, it's got needles. Again, reminds me of Game of Thrones, only instead of swords, needles. A halo-like ring. Examine the throne. As you study it, a memory bubbles up and bursts into your consciousness. Inifere sits motionless on the throne. Marcissa adjusts dials on its back. The children gather around, like supplicants seeking an audience. "Now," Marcissa intones, "be one with the Master." Inifere has only an instant to ponder how he has consented to this abomination before the vastening overtakes him. The children wail, writhe, soil themselves, vomit. One staggers to his feet and drags a dagger across her throat. Another gouges out his eyes. Oh my god. They're hearing the voices, feeling the loathing that has festered inside Inifere. It's more than mortals can bear. It's sublime. His memory ends. His shame lingers. So he hates them all so much that when they feel his emotions and thoughts, they kill themselves. Apparently. Marcissa rises to her feet, a bit unsteadily. She examines both you and herself as if searching for physical evidence of the peril you've escaped. She finds none. The sorrow's violence fell upon others, who remain at its mercy beyond the vault door. Master, tell me how I may serve, what I may endure in your cause. Hidden through Inifere may be. Hidden though Inifere may be, his contempt at this continued fraud burns in your gut like acid. What is this place? Marcissa gives you an odd look, as if you should know the answer, as if it is madness to ask a tourist's question while death itself roams the halls, but she replies all the same. This is the Sanctum Sanctorum, where sibyls shared their lucid dreams with princes and peasants and popes. She smiles faintly. You wanted a place where you could be alone. I gave it to you. You remember, Inifere remembers, the day you came to this retreat, more fortress than temple, hacked from granite hills, not alone, the children trailing you like chicks, but inside the promise of solitude, a false promise like all the ones life makes. There's a new sound, almost masked by the humming of the ancient lights. It's coming from the vault door. It seems the sorrow has made its way through the children. Oh. Coward, hisses a ghostly voice. Shame, but they are not the ones calling to Inifere now. It is the temptation of the gate, the promise that he will outlast another day. Enough with the charade. Inifere. How does this throne work? Marcissa shrugs. It's a mystery. When you sat upon it, we shared in the ecstasy of your suffering. When the sibyls sat upon it, they shared your dreams. Only the Harefi who assembled it for them can say how it works, and he has long since turned to dust. I know only enough to activate and amplify the device. Suddenly, a huge blister forms on the vault door, glowing white. Moments later, another blister rises, and the huge ancient barrier begins to take on the look of a leper's face. That the door is yielding to the sorrow is perhaps less surprising than it's holding at all. Indeed, it seems that the barrier has some life in it still. Despite its disfigurement, there are not yet any signs of structural failure. Okay, so we have time for more options then. Inifere, your mind's bleeding into mine. Can you use that to give me Choi's remains before it's too late? No, Inifere answers. You are seeking a way into me, a way to cut deeper. No, I won't be fooled. Anamnesis? This is going to use up the rest of our intelligence. You press your will down upon Inifere's consciousness, wrap him up in it, and squeeze until Choi oozes out like a drop of juice from a dried-up fruit. You lap her up. From Inifere comes nothing but rage, rage at his own impotence, rage at your theft, and from Choi comes the sound of faint weeping echoing in the recesses of your mind. Whatever your grief, whatever hers, you will surely make a better home. You surely make for a better home than Inifere. For a moment, the vault door still holds. Though more blisters have risen and burst across its surface, it is only a matter of time before the sorrow gains entry. Enough with the charade, Marcissa. I know you don't believe in any of this. Marcissa frowns. Master? She begins, before trailing off. She stares intently, perhaps reading Inifere as easily as he read her. Eventually, she shakes her head. You're wrong. There is something I believed in, all this time. If I could help you find some good in all your suffering, prove that it gave hope to others, meaning to others, if I could lighten your burden even a gram, then... She shakes her head again. We've all suffered, Inifere. There must be something good born from it, even if only a noble lie. Inifere's jaded senses can find no falsehood in her, and you feel him sink even further into despair as he realizes hypocrite is not Sorry, as he realizes Marcissa is not the hypocrite he believed. We can't escape suffering with lies, Marcissa, only with understanding. Marcissa shakes her head. No, she answers. The more I understand of the world, the more I see to hate. Her sad, ugly face twists in a sad, ugly smile. Sometimes, Master, I'm afraid you've come to understand too much, and now you're alone in a dark truth. But thanks to that, you will shine all the brighter for the children. For a moment, Inifere's consciousness stirs, and an image spills from his mind to yours. A lighthouse above a wild sea, its lamp drawing in desperate storm-tossed sailors, even as cyclopean monsters circle its base, waiting, hungering, exulting. Now the doors become mottled. Its alloyed ancient elements are separating. A lattice of hairline cracks appears, and you hear a low moaning, as of a beast that has endured too much punishment. The dead voices cackle about vanity and futility and how all that you touch turns to schist, and the others give their own message, the comfort of a familiar whip and the promise you won't perish. So I can just wait, or I can say Inifere, or I can sit on the throne, or open the vault door. Sit on the throne and face the sorrow in a final ambush. You can learn more about your enemy, and Inifere can redeem himself. As you step toward the throne, you involuntarily recoil in revulsion. Inifere has returned. Never again, Inifere hisses. Something wells up beyond what was in his memory, a sense that to sit upon a throne is to carry the danger or her perversion a step further, spreading one's own pollution into the world. And even more than that is the fear of losing control, that once the floodgates of suffering are opened, there will be no closing them again, no more quiet floating above the agony inside him. Force him? Respect? This is the reason for your suffering, Inifere. It's a weapon to wield against our common foe. No, Inifere answers. I am not a tool. Not his, not yours. His will wells up. And in the end, it is yours that yields. It is coming now. There is stillness in the air, the prickle of a storm about to burst. The tides are being stirred. Marcissa feels it too. She stops her pacing and stares at the vault door, at the widening, hissing cracks. Inifere feels it and twitches free from his stupor. Terror has put its spurs to him, and those beyond the gate offer a lump of salt. Now this is his past, right? So he must have... you know, escaped or triumphed, otherwise triumphed against the sorrow, otherwise, unless just by being here we're changing the events. The door bursts, the sorrow enters, the gate opens, flaming, fetid, familiar, beyond is pain and those who delight in pain. As the sorrow ponders this interruption, Inifere runs toward the gate, closer, closer. You smell the sulfur. But the sorrow has your scent now, and moves like the wind, too fast. No, cries Marcissa, diving between you and the sorrow. She slows it only for an instant before it turns her to a red mist. It's enough. Inifere crosses over. Well, I try to help her. Behind you, the sorrow floats impotently. It cannot, or will not, cross the threshold. It goes. Then the pain comes, a great wave that washes all else away, and you're drowning in it. And at last your mind can bear no more. We leveled up or something? I barely heard her say something. Dominant tides have shifted. Never has your body been a more welcome home than when returning from Inifere's mirror. I guess we could have gotten something here, or maybe we lost something, the mirrorcaster. Though his wretchedness lingers in your memory, you see again through your own eyes, and even this horrific place seems more wholesome than the refuge where Inifere faced the sorrow. Inifere stares at you with newfound recognition. But even as he does, you feel a dark presence stirring around you, the same one you sensed in the mirror. Something has sensed your meddling, and means to put an end to it. Sorrow. Inifere smiles, for the first time without spite. Sister, he says softly, not so little, not so young. Now you are truly flesh of my flesh. Then he shudders as if he has taken a chill, and a shadow passes over his face. Kiyotawa reminds him of Narcissa. You need to close the gate. Kill yourself. I'd like to ask you some more questions. For a moment, Inifere seems ready to invite your inquiry. Then his smile grows wide and wolfish, his eyes wild. He laughs, always grasping, clasping, rasping at my thoughts, trying with wiles to file my mind to a shape that suits your needs. No, he shakes his head. No, sister. Now we will see how you care to be carved upon. And with that, he readies himself for battle. No! I wanted to talk him out of it. Oh god, he attacks- what? How many times does he attack? I can't level up yet. Ah! Maybe I can on my turn? Oh, this thing's still here?
It's all in the flick of the wrist.
And he missed. I want to move him forward. I can only move this much.
Alright.
Kiyotawa's gonna attack us? That's what her portrait? It looks like just globules of blood. Oh, she can't. Oh! I'm out of intellect. Yeah, I'm gonna use that. Barrel of Indomitability. I'm not sure if that caused any damage to him. Yeah, I can't level up. Concentrated play flesh. She thanked herself. Oh, this thing again.
Something new is wrong
with me. Ow. Oh god. Oh, she's down. We are all very damaged. Yeah, I don't know. I don't think we're gonna live this.
I hope no one saw that.
Yeah, he completely missed.
Could someone stab some healing into me?
Yeah. I'm afraid he's gonna die next round. I'm afraid we're all gonna die. I'd love to move him out of the way. As I hate it, I'm gonna save myself this time. Okay, teleport yourself. Over here. See if this will work. Root spike. 15 physical damage, immobilized. Character cannot move. 2 more damage per turn, which is really small, but the main thing is the 15 damage and the root spike thing. Is he immobilized? No, this thing's attacking again. Bye, Aridus. Oh, he's not paralyzed.
Can't say I mind that. Barely holding on.
Damn. Okay. He has 52 left. I don't think we can beat him. You can always try, right? Tiber's turn. He has might, doesn't he? This is might. Yeah, just have him attack.
Barely making a scratch.
I'll try to get him away from this thing. Negative fennels, and yeah, do that thing. Can I move away too? Crap. Yeah. Goodbye, cruel world.